One day kasi nasa mall ako noon. May tumawag sa akin, sabi, "Uy, ang cute mo." Siyempre na-offend ako noon kasi sabi nga nila, the truth hurts. Naalala ko noon, sumakay ako ng jeep. Kahit hindi rush hour, siksikan talaga. Tapos may binili ako sa bayan noon eh. Pagpunta ko ng bayan, nauso ang crush ng bayan. Siyempre, dati may struggle din ako. So, naglayas ako. Doon nauso yung search for Mr. Pogi. During high school, nabanda ako sa library. Kasi, hindi nasusunod yung observe silence na rules nila. Bilib talaga ako sa mga taong kalmado lang kapag dumadaan ako.
Good afternoon, good evening, and good night. So, today, we'll be discussing the introduction or yung law enforcement operation mismo. So, this will be your first lecture in a law enforcement operation with planning and crime mapping. So, it's one of the few more videos. So, let's jump right through it. So, first, before discussing yung mga operation, may mga introduction muna natin. So, in this lecture, we'll be discussing about the certain guidelines before conducting any law enforcement operation. So, before that, meron tayong general principles, which is the strategic guidelines, the two, and meron din tayong general guidelines. So, dito, regardless of the type of the function of to be performed and or police operation to be conducted, kahit anong unit yan, police unit, kahit ba maritime, airport, or kung kahit anong operation yan, arrest, research, mga ganun, all PNP personnel daw must know by heart and shall comply with the following principle and procedures na dapat na-internalize na ng every PNP member ito. To serve and protect and to respect the human rights and dignity of the person. So, what do you mean by serve and protect? So, dahil pag-aari na ng government, yung police, you must be a public, you are a public parang officer na. So, you must put first the public before, actually before yourself. Kasi, parang pagmamayari ka na ng government. And, you must protect the public as well as to serve them. So, hindi ka dapat, pag naghihingi sila ng police clearance or kung ano mang documents or nagtatanong sila, you entertain them with courtesy, with respect. Ayun. Also, to respect rights and dignity of the person. So, meron na tayong discuss natin yung mga constitutional and yung statutory rights ng mga person which the PNP must know. Yung mga yun. The right to life, the right to liberty, the right to property. Kasi if they violate even one from it, is they may be liable for criminal or civil charges. Ayun. Or, to be specific, if they do not value human dignity and rights in any conducted law enforcement operation, kahit nga sa arrest, kung hindi nila sinabi yung Miranda rights, di ba? The arrest will be deemed inadmissible. And ma-acquit yung suspect. Kahit kitang-kita na siya yung gumawa talaga. So, yun. Marami talaga yung dapat i-internalize ng isang PNP member. So, general guidelines. So, police uniforms and accessory. So, 1.1 is actually talks about the different uniform. So, 1.2, when wearing the police uniform, a police officer shall at all times appear to look presentable, respectable, smart, and well-groomed. Police officer shall refrain from doing unnecessary activities or action while on duty. So, yan na nga. So, when you are wearing a uniform, dapat snappy, di ba? Naka-tuck in. It must look presentable sa public. Kasi nga, it reflects sa uniform din yung PNP organization, di ba? So, it must look smart, must looks proper, must look snappy, hindi yung lousy. Ayun. So, these are the types of uniform. So, di ko alam yung mga kung ano yung schedule nila or kung kailan nila wine-wear tong mga uniform na to. Pero ito yung mga itsura nila. So, PNP GOA Type A uniform bush coat. Pang commission officer lang ata to, from police lieutenant up to police general. Ito, PNP GOA Type B. So, ito. Walang bush coat. PNP GOA Type C. So, ayun. Difference niya is mas marami yung ibang uniform, accessories ng uniform. Highway Patrol Group naman. So, ito yung siguro aware na kayo dito kasi tayo yung parang dinadaanan lang natin sila. Ayan, pixelized field service uniform. Camouflage green. Black tropical. Usually, I think yung nagwe-wear dito is mga airport police. And yung mga ganyan na camouflage green is yung mga regional mobile force natin. Yun. Ito naman pag nagpapatrol yung police, usually ito yung makikita natin sa may police car, di ba? Ito naman pag may riot or may rally at kailangan ng police dun, dapat kompleto. Search and rescue naman pag may disaster. Yan yung uniform nila. Pag tourist naman, eto. Meron yung short for beach na nature park na short pant. Pero pag urban commercial center, long pant. At may tatak na sa likod nila, tourist, police. Pag athletics naman, ito yung tsura. Ito yung ato yung nakikita palagi natin sa office, di ba? So, yun. Those are the different uniforms. One of the guidelines also for police uniform and accessories is the carrying of basic police equipment, especially in patrol. So, whether on board a vehicle, whether vehicle patrol or foot patrol, shall always carry with him his her issued firearm. So, dapat meron yung baril mo as a police. And other equipment, siguro may flashlight paggabi, megaphone, mga ganun, and etc. and etc. So, para you're always ready. So, mga handcuffs din, mga ganun. So, punta tayo sa categories of police operation. Ito yung papag-usapan actually natin or meron akong papag-group work sa inyo dito. So, there are certain categories or types of police operation. May patrol operation, control, considers as the most basic police function and the backbone of policing. Ito yung mostly ginagawa ng police for crime prevention, di ba? And as well, crime detection. Law enforcement operation, which includes arrest, implementation of arrest warrant, search warrant, and other criminality operation. Pag internal security operation naman is for those na mga that endangers the internal security of the nation. So, sino yung mga nag-endanger ng internal security natin? Sa loob, internal, sa loob ng state ng country natin. So, sino? Mga counter-insurgency, di ba, na organization tulad ng CTG, Communist Terrorist Groups, di ba? So, they cause internal security threats kasi they try to disturb yung government, especially, and even the people. So, internal nagkakandak yung PNP ng internal security operations. Public safety operations. So, for the public health naman, tulad pag may disaster, di ba, conduct search and rescue, mas hostage situation, ano pa ba? This pandemic, di ba, may mga checkpoint na those are public safety operation. So, special police operation naman, include high-risk checkpoint. Iba sa checkpoint ng pang-health, public safety. Pero high-risk for especially pag may drugs, di ba? Na dapat nilang mag-checkpoint sa isang area para mahuli. Roadblock operation. Police assistant in the implementation of order from the court. Another, and etc. etc. So, those are makikita niyo naman sa PNP operations manual, which I will link it to your Google Class, kung ano yung ginagawa nila dito. Anti-kidnapping pa at, hindi ba? Hindi pala. Basta, you'll see there. Investigation operation, si ADG, SOCO, ganun. Police community relations, so they need this, one of the categories of police operation kasi, to parang improve the image of the PNP kasi nga, di ba, medyo nasira-sira dahil sa mga cases ng drugs. So, they need this. And also for community policing, which they involve the public for them to make for crime prevention, crime detection. Operational guidelines. So, in every operation conducted, all PNP members shall respect and uphold the human rights and dignity of all person at all times. So, in all pre-operational clearance. So, in all conducted operation, arrest man yan, arrest pa, checkpoint, maganyan, dapat the team leader must secure a pre-operational clearance sa head of, sa chief nila. Chief ng team leader, commander, head of office or unit, mga ganun. Siyempre may paper yan. Paper, magpagpasa ka muna ng paper at i-approve. Tapos yun, pag na-approve, saka ka mag-operate. So yun. Coordination naman. So, in some operation, di ba, kailangan nila ng magpaalam muna sa ibang unit. So, for example, di ba sa SAF, wherein they need to para tugisin or they will need to arrest yung Middle Eastern ata yun, si Marwan, is they need to parang coordinate sana with other agency dun sa, nakalimutan ko na yung place, pero before conducting a special police operation, they must coordinate with the local police nila dun through inter-office coordination, through filing coordination form, or meron din yung itatawag mo na lang na i-inform mo sila na mag-ooperate sila. So dito, pag inter-office coordination, so for example, you are SAF, mag-operate kayo dun sa bandang Nueva Vizcaya. So dapat i-inform mo yung mga police station na malapit sa Nueva Vizcaya. So yun. Pag coordination by filing coordination form, ikaw na SAF dito, may kukunak ang operation dun sa Vizcaya, mag-coordinate ka by filing coordination form. So, ito yung paper. So, ibigay mo dun sa police station sa Nueva Vizcaya. Also, if talagang kailang walang oras mag-file ng coordination form, for example, then pwede mo naman namang itawag, di ba? Through practical or available means of communication. So, yun. So, after the operation, through practical available means, mag-incident report ka na lang sa nag-operatean niya na malapit na police station. So, yun. That's for the coordination. So, punta tayo sa requirements of police operation. So, before conduct operation, may mga basic requirement. So, number one is marked vehicle. So, hindi dapat private na vehicle ang gagamitin, no? Dapat may tatak. May blue and green, red lights, may police. Yung plaka niya is red, ganun. Led by a PCO or the most senior PNCO. So, dapat when you're conducting arrest, meron dapat police commission officer na makaalalay or the most senior police non-commissioned officer. C naman, with personnel in prescribed your police uniform except for, so dapat naka-uniform ka pag-arrest or any other, pero kapag covert operation tulad ng mga inter-security operation, pagan hindi na kailangan. Pag internal security operation tulad ng pagtugis ng mga CTGs. Yun lang yung exception dito sa letter C. And D, ito yung pinakabagong requirement. The use of body-worn camera or alternative recording devices during searches and arrest. So, ito is dahil parang uniform na kasi yung parang mga rason ng pulis pag may namatay sa pag-aresto, especially sa mga drug cases na puro na lang nanlaban. So, it's high time dahil nga other countries din is using body-worn cameras. Why not the PNP uses this also? So, ano kaya tong body-worn camera? Actually, wait lang. Ito yung itsura niya. Body-worn camera na kiniklip sa arresting officer. Na when an arrest is happening, you must turn it on para ma-record lahat. So yun. So may mga guidelines ng pag-use nito pero mamaya nating i-discuss. So the use of megaphone and similar instrument devices. So, during the actual police intervention operations, the team leader shall use peaceful means, including the use of megaphones or any other similar instruments to warn, influence. So, the police are authorized to use the megaphones, especially during rally, riot, or whistle, para to inform the suspect to surrender. And also other accessories like the first aid, the vest, flashlight, paggabi, handcuffs, whenever it is possible. Handheld radio, they can carry this one. So, punta tayo sa use of body-worn camera. If you want to know the definition of the body-worn camera, just search for AM number 21-06-08 Supreme Court. This is yung parang konting nabasa ko lang dito kasi nga bago siya, medyo bago siya. Body-worn camera is parang ibibigay yan ng agency sa mga police station. Hindi yung ano ba yan? You will buy a body-worn camera from the outside sa Lazada, ganun. Hindi ganun. Body-worn camera is issued by the agency. Siguro DILG or NAPALCOM, it's a government issued. Yung ARD naman is alternative recording device wherein pag walang body worn camera, they can use the any other recording devices like your cell phone. Pero may mga requirement yan. Dapat pasado sa korte. So magfa-file ka pa ng ex parte ata motion na you will see to it if it's ex parte ba. Basta you will parang ipa-check mo sa korte or prosecution, pa-check niyo yung dalawa sa or if it's proper, pwedeng gamitin to record. Kasi nga medyo mabagal yung usad ng budget. At I think hindi pa nabibigyan ng body worn camera yung other station. ARD yung parang kanilang alternative recording device, yung kanilang remedyo. So pag nakakanda ka ng arrest, search, dapat may body worn camera. One body worn camera and one alternative recording device yung minimum requirement ng korte. Pero pag walang body worn camera, dalawang alternative recording devices. So there is always actually exception to the rule na kapag hindi nasira yung body worn camera, is nasira sa pag hindi conduct of arrest, mag-affidavit ka na lang na nasira. And it will still make the arrest admissible. Pag use pala ng body worn camera ang ARD is within the conduct of the arrest na, parang pag mag-aresto ka na, mag-serve ka ng warrant, i-on mo na until natapos yung aresto. Saka mo i-off. So yun. And marami pang guidelines dito. Doon sa 21-06-08. Introduction lang yung sinasabi ko. So sa chain of custody nito, nangyayari is nga, ni-record sa aresto yung ginawang pag-aresto, di ba? So yung body worn camera, ito turn over sa data custodian. So yung data custodian, isang law enforcement officer din sa station ninyo, para siya yung mag-handle ng pag-redact or pag-download sa computer. So the download ng data custodian sa computer and ire-redact niya. Kung for example, sex offenses yung may mga minor, lalagyan niya ng line yung mga mata para hindi sila ma-identify. Mga ganun. Yung mga very sensitive information, ire-redact ng data custodian or his or her representative. After that, ilalagay niya sa isang external media storage device. USB man lang or CD. And then, you submit it to the court. The data custodian will submit it in the court. Yung pag-turnover, from the moment na na-turnover sa data custodian to the moment of pagda-download, pagre-redact, pagre-retrieve, dapat magawa mo yan in, and pagsasubmit, dapat magawa mo yan in 24 hours. So, yun. So, there are specific things dito na maaari mo lang magamit yung BWC or hindi mo siya magamit in a police facilities unless in an official capacity. So, if it's not official yet na parang hindi nyo pa kinakondak yung arrest, wag mong i-on yung BWC mo na nandun kayo sa police station para hindi ma-record yung police facility. Pero pag part siya ng arrest na nasagip yung police station, then okay lang. Kasi official, in official capacity ka naman. Conduct of any personal activity. So, pag, for example, ng personal activities, pag si CR, dapat hindi mo i-activate dun. Di ba? Ano pa ba? Three is conduct of any personal activity in location where the individual has reasonable observation of. So you cannot turn on your body worn camera in places wherein may mga tao na for their privacy, na may ginagawa sila, nagsasampay, ganun, wag mo dapat i-record yung mga yun. During strip search, so you cannot turn on your body worn camera in strip or body cavity searches. Ito yung titignan nila, di ba, yung mga ari-arian ng isang tao. Ari-arian, cavity search. So you must turn off it. Conduct of tactical planning. When you are planning for the arrest, you must not turn on your body worn camera. So if there is a communication between a member of a PNP to another member of the PNP na wala silang alam na tinurn on mo na yung body worn camera mo, it should not be. You should not do that. You should not also record yung confidential informants mo, yung mga intel officer mo, mga undercover officer, so that they will not know their identity. Or yung privilege communication na kapag mag-uusap yung guardians to the minor, wag mong i-record. Or yung counsel niya, yung attorney niya sa suspect, wag mong i-record. Ano pa ba? Or sa priest. While on the ground, so if meron kayo sa school, wag mong i-record yung school or sa hospital, except when you are responding to an imminent threat to life or health. Other circumstances may be provided by the trial court issuing. So, meron actually yan sa sinabi kong circular or memo ng Supreme Court. So, that's it for the body worn camera. Medyo hindi siya detailed, pero parang introduction lang. So, punta tayo sa use of force policy. The application of necessary and reasonable force. In the lawful performance of duty, a police official shall use necessary and reasonable force to accomplish his or her mandated task of enforcing the law and maintaining peace and order. So, yung sinasabi niya dito is, for example, in making arrest, you must use reasonable force. Now, what do you mean by reasonable force? Dapat hindi siya bitin, hindi siya over yung paggamit mo na force na pag-aresta sa person sa kanyang react sa pag-react ng isang suspect. So kung hindi naman nagre-resist yung suspect, wag mong putukan ng baril. Kasi that is not a reasonable force. Unreasonable force na yun, di ba? So, a police, yung factors to determine kung ano yung reaction ng isang suspect is kung ilan sila, kung may weapon ba siya, ano yung nature and characteristics of weapon, either deadly weapon ba yan, non-deadly, baril ba yan, or batuta lang. Physical condition, kung mas malaki ba siya sa'yo. Size and other circumstances to include the place and occasion of the assault. Paggabi ba? Or marami bang pwedeng pagtakasan ng suspect sa pag-aresto mo? So, these are the parang circumstances that you must observe para maka-come up ka ng reasonable force. So, for example, night time. Di ba? Hindi mo night time at nakita mo na medyo ba marami siyang pwedeng papuntahan. So, yung maganda yun dun na gawin mo is parang arestuhin mo na agad. Parang use a reasonable force wherein you use a soft hand technique kasi baka tatakas. Or pag marami sila, you use, I think, or meron siyang deadly weapon din, and your life is in danger as a police officer, that's the time you use Gun. So, with that reasonable force na i-employ mo to subdue the suspect must be sufficient para hindi ka na ma your life mas hindi na in danger yung life mo or pa and ma-overcome mo yung aggression ng offender and etc. Sabi dito, the excessive force is not being practiced dapat. Kasi pwede kang ma-aresto or pwede kang makasuhan na sa police officer or pwedeng maging void yung or pwede siyang ma-acquit dahil sa kapalpakan mo sa pag-aresto. Di ba? So, lahat to is parang applicable, hindi lang sa arrest, lahat ng law enforcement operation that the reaction of the suspect or the situation must be commensurate to the reasonable force that you must employ as a law enforcement officer. So, meron tayong mga na-videohan, di ba, nung pandemic, si Mr. Police Master Sergeant Daniel Florendo Jr. Nakalimitan ko yung place pero may mentally ill na dating sundalo na nakatakas tapos nagugulo. Pero itong si Police Master Sergeant, tinutukan niya na agad ng baril. Eh, kitang-kita naman na walang baril yung dating sundalo. At sinasabihan pa ng mga tambay dito na walang hindi yan pumapatay, parang may konting mentally ill lang. So, nung siguro we can understand Florendo kasi hinuhugot niya daw yung bag niya, yung sundalo. So, anong gagawin mo sa police? Dapat wag agad-agad bumunot ng baril, di ba? Pero ito, bumugot siya agad ng baril. Sinabihin pa ata niya na yung mga tambay na huwag kayong mangyalam. So, nung nangyari, pinatay niya yung mentally ill na sundalo. Nakasuhan si Mas Police Master Sergeant Daniel Florendo Jr. At dito, nasira ulit yung image ng PNP. So, yun. So, there is what we call the force continuum. It's a linear progressive decision-making process which displays the array of police reasonable response commensurate to the level. So ito, there is parang step ang force continuum na there is a certain response to the suspect. There is a certain police response to the suspect threats or resistance. So there are three approaches by the police. May lethal approach, may less lethal approach, and may non-lethal approach. In the first, lethal approach, if you may encounter as a police officer, yung threat ng suspect is he may harm you, serious physical injury, or he may kill you may use your handgun to protect yourself. Self-defense, or pag naman hindi ikaw yung tinutukan ng baril, yung stranger, pwede ka pa rin gumamit ng baril para barilin mo yung suspect kasi meron tayong defense of stranger, di ba? And other justifying circumstances sa criminal law 1. Less lethal approach naman, if the suspect is in assaultive resistance, meaning he is using his bodily force, he is unarmed, kaso may bodily force siya, malakas siya, and sumusuntok siya ganun. And you may use of impact weapons tulad ng batuta, ganun. Pag naman, active resistance, parang konti lang sa assaultive resistance, hindi siya nananakit pero nagre-resist pa siya. You use physical control, hard hand technique yung you use yung You use for your physical force to subdue him. Pag passive naman, na medyo hindi siya nagre-resist, soft hands lang na konting force sa physical control. Pag non-verbal or verbal non-compliance, hindi siya nakikinig sa'yo, pagsabihan mo para makinig siya. Or pag cooperative naman yung suspect, okay na yung police presence na i-approach mo siya, and then if he's subject to arrest, then i-arrest mo siya. And after that, the de-escalation. So, we have discussed this kanina. Non-lethal approach. So, ito, parang ipa-discuss pa natin. If the suspect is compliant and cooperative, you must, as a police officer, display professional and respectable deportment, wear the prescribed uniform. Pag naman non-compliant siya, do not present immediate, pero hindi siya armed. Use sign language pag pipi siya. Dapat loud and firm yung pagsalita mo. Dapat alam niya yung sinasabi mo. Pwede kang mag-whistle or mga yung physical hard technique or soft hand technique yung gamitin mo. Ayun, same goes with this one. Less lethal naman, if he is an arm, pero non-compliant siya, he is actively or passively resistant, you may use, ano ba yan, impact weapons tulad ng baton, truncheon, or nightstick. Pero, exert due diligence in the employment of reasonable force through impact weapons and ensure that it will not cause serious injury or death. Huwag mo siyang banatan or i-hit yung mga very sensitive part tulad ng head. Siguro sa arms niya, sa buttocks niya, pwede yun. Target only the fleshy part. So, hindi dapat sa bones. Tulad ng arms, torso, legs, and thighs. As much as possible ito, do not hit the head, neck, face, groin, kidneys, or other spinal column or other sensitive area para hindi mamatay or hindi masugatan ng grabe yung i-aresto mo, for example, yung suspect. Pero kapag lethal approach na, he is armed and dangerous dito. Unlawful aggression or intention to cause severe injury, serious bodily harm to not only to the police officer but to the people around, you may use weapon. Pero dapat avoid hitting the head para hindi siya instant na mamamatay. Wound him para ma-disable lang siya. Para hindi siya mapatay. Ganun. Pero this is the last result. Resort, I mean. So after that, if the suspect has complied, cooperate or surrender, the police officer must de-escalate to the appropriate level of approach. However, he shall remain vigilant on the possibility of escalation of response. So, for example, after ng lethal, tapos niyang gumamit ka ng lethal approach, parang nakuha mo na yung baril niya, de-escalate mo na. Siguro, less lethal na lang yung gagamitin, no? Para hindi siya makaalis sa para hindi siya hindi pa ma-escalate yung hindi pa siya magalit. Ganun. Pero dapat vigilant ka para baka kasi may tinatago siyang baril ganun or may iba pa siyang way para patayin ka as a police officer. So what are your responsibilities of the police officer in charge of the operation? So the police officer who is in charge of the operation at all time observe the force continuum and exercise control over the police personnel area to protect lives and properties. So, siguro mga team leader yung mga ito. So you must be the one who is responsible in informing your subordinates or your team para they will observe the force continuum, the proper responses to as categorized by lethal approach, non-lethal approach, and the less lethal approach. So, the use of firearm during police operation. Sabi dito, only when you are in an imminent danger of causing death or injury to the person, you may use your firearm. So, kung papatayin ka or i-injure ka ng bonggang-bongga, you may use actually the justifying circumstances of self-defense, defense of a relative, and defense of a stranger. So sabi dito, sa self-defense, your situation must happen that your life is really in danger or in peril before you induct this justifying circumstances. Circumstance, I mean. Ano pa? Sabi pa dito, the police shall not use warning shots during police operation except when the police officer is outnumbered and overpowered and his or her life is in imminent danger. Sabi dito, the other way around, you will only conduct or shoot warning shots when you are in danger or papatayin or marami siya sila, you are outnumbered. So it is prohibited for you to fire at moving vehicles. So a moving vehicle and its occupant shall not be fired upon except when its occupant poses imminent danger. So same din dito, you will same din sa sa warning shot na if you are in imminent danger or there is an imminent danger to the life of this stranger, siguro may nakita kang riding in tandem na papatayin yung isang tao, you may use this, you may fire at the vehicle of the or you may fire at the direction of the motor vehicle of the riding in tandem. Pero justifiable dapat na pag putok mo, walang tao na masusugatan sa pagputok mo ng baril, walang ma-accidental death or accidental harm sa bullet ng firearm mo, and etc. Ganun. So, in firing at moving vehicles, these are the parameters. So, is there an imminent danger to the police officer or to the person this being targeted? Is parang malapit na bang patayin niya? Is it certain na kung hindi mo bubunutin yung baril mo is mamamatay ka or mamamatay yung papatayin ng riding in tandem, for example? Or may mga tao ba na nasa malapit sa direction ng puputakan mong riding in tandem? Ayun. So, if you have fired in an operation, if you have fired your firearm, your service firearm in an operation, after that, you must submit an incident report kung bakit mo finire ang yung firearm mo. Parang yun yung protocol nila after firing such firearm. So, immediately after an armed confrontation, the official in charge of the operation, when applicable, shall secure the site of confrontation. So, yung mga team leader, I think, kasi, or the person in charge with the whole operation, for example, may may involved na hostage situation. After ng hostage situation na yun at na-de-escalate na yung situation, you must secure the site of confrontation. Lagyan mo ng police, mga police line. Check whether the situation still poses imminent danger. May mga bomba pang nilagay yung hostage taker, for example. Take photographs. Evacuate all the wounded people to the hospital. Keep arrested in suspects in isolation. Ilayo mo sa public. Ay, ilayo mo siya. Isolate mo siya. Conduct the briefing on all involved PNP operatives. Submit after operation officer and ensure psychological stress counseling for all. So after yung last part, i-reform mo sila sa mga neuropsychiatric, neuro, hindi, sa mga psychiatric clinic para kung ma, kasi medyo traumatic din actually pag may napatay kayo na service. So you must put them on a counseling yung mga involved. So that's it for today and thank you for listening.